45 or 46 parables that Jesus told. And parables are stories, and they run counter to our Western Enlightenment mindset about how to teach. So I really want to give lots of people opportunities to reflect on the meaning of those stories, especially as it appeals to them personally. So this is like appointment television. Oh. Every single Saturday. Okay. We're going to have a guest post by somebody reflecting on parables. The Western view of church, especially the Western metric for success, is something that I think is not healthy for us as individuals or as congregations. But the last 15 years in our church, one of the phrases that I use is, I have to get people lost again before I can get them saved again. You know, the view is that, yeah, well, I got saved when I was 6 years old or 9 years old. And, you know, they look at it as a one-time event. And, you know, when in fact that's the doorway through which we walk. And then we end up on this journey of becoming conformed to the image of Christ. So, the practical applications are to first of all deconstruct what people have been told is the salvation experience. It's not one and done. You know, bought the T-shirt, and then the second part of that is the idea that that salvation is all about going to heaven when you die, because if that's the case, and this is a really old phrase, it's not mine. If salvation's all about going to heaven when you die, you only need two preachers. You need one to get them saved and one to shoot them in the head. But you know, what about the rest of our life?
Yeah.
Give me a Lortab, or give me the spiritual version of a Lortab. And I don't care that, you know, there's something in my life recurrent that causes that pain.
Have you had any experience with spiritual direction or having a spiritual director or anything like that?
I'll do a commercial for a ministry that I really, really like called Sustainable Faith, which is based in Cincinnati, Ohio. I have an Obi-Wan that I check in with from time to time by the name of Dave Nixon. And you can go to sustainablefaith.com. And he's from a Christian community. And they actually bought an old Catholic church, as well as the rectory and as well as the convent where the nuns used to stay.
Wow.
But it's in an urban setting. It's in Cincinnati. And so I've gone up there both to receive spiritual direction and to be trained a little bit in spiritual direction.
I know I've often really bristled at that word direction, because I feel like I can walk with someone in a peer situation, and more of a companion, spiritual companion. However, there is something to be said that I don't know how your direction goes, but with my spiritual director, there's a lot of question asking, and there's a clear role that one person is making space for God and inviting you into that. Is that how it goes for you?
Yeah, no, really well said. We are such individualists. We're so independent in America, especially, that the idea of having a director brings up all kind of connotations.
Yeah.
And yet at the same time, spiritual direction calls for really defined roles. And I love your experience when you say that someone's asking you pointed questions. And the questions, it's not like getting them right or wrong. It's the questions are the breadcrumbs along the path, you know, that are going to lead you to a deeper walk with Jesus. So
right. That's
a good thing. And yeah, my experiences, both receiving and in those rare cases where people would entrust me to do that, it's the same sort of relationship.
I've also had some counseling, and I've appreciated the focus of spiritual direction as, like, we're not just talking about a bunch of problems, but we're talking about where is God in each thing that we're going through, whether it's a victory or a joy, or just a lot of times for me it's just a crossroads, and you know, my director will say, where is God, where do you sense God in this? And then sometimes those lies are unveiled then, of things I wrongly believe about God. Do you wind up having that similar experience?
Yeah, for sure. A friend of mine came up with a phrase that rocked my world about 3 or 4 months ago. She said that a lot of people look at God the Father as angry and wrathful, and that the ministry of Jesus is to stand between us and an angry God to appease him.
Right.
Much like an older brother to keep, you know, the younger children away from the abusive dad. And, you know, when she used that image, it really spoke to me quite a bit. Because so many people see it as Father bad, God good. That's it. Try that again. Father bad, Jesus good.
Right.
When in fact, you know, they are one heart, one spirit, you know, and they're of, you know, one essence. Thank
right.
you.
And I really appreciate you just breaking up your day and speaking with me like this. It's been really nice.
You know, like I said, it was a bad hair day.
Me too.